Dan has traveled all over the world crusading on behalf of the sportsmen, women, and children. This and all other programs produced by Dan are intended to be both entertaining and educational. It is not our intentions to offend anyone. However, we must advise this program does contain explicit kill scenes. Dan Fitzgerald Family Outdoor Entertainment. Spanning the globe in order to bring you sportsmen, women, and children the most entertaining and educational programs available today. America is home to most species of fish and wildlife, which are wary, crafty, keen, and very clever when in and around human activity, becoming more and more aware of man's pursuit due to large number of sportsmen and women taking to the woods and water. This makes it more and more difficult to bag a trophy. We do not make guarantees, but each year, thousands of folks will obtain a new level of success after attending Dan Fitzgerald's Bow Hunting School. Welcome to Dan Fitzgerald's ABCs for Successful Hunting video series. This lesson, Advanced Shooting and Hunting Techniques. Taught by Dan Fitzgerald, with over 40 years experience as a bow hunter, seminar speaker, and product design engineer. You'll learn from Dan's PhD, or Philosophy of Hunting Deer. Guy Fitzgerald, an experienced bow hunter and angler in his mid-teens, began wetting a line as a toddler. Has his own line of fishing products, Knack, Not a Chance, for the fish, that is. Brought to you in part by the following manufacturers: Muzzy, Mountaineer, Deer Miser, DuPont Polaris, Aero Adventure Products, Paul Seating, and Fitzgerald Outdoor Products. Now here is Dan in person to pour out his heart, hoping to help you reach a new level of success.
Excuse me, where are you going? Do you know where Dan's bow hunting school is?
Oh, that's where I'm headed.
Really?
Can't you read the sign?
Oh, dummy me.
You're going to get lost in the woods that way.
Down this way, right?
Yep, let's go.
All right.
Welcome to the Dan Fitzgerald Bow Hunting School. We're going to talk about a lot of things that you like in this class, I think. But the most important thing, how would you like to talk about bow hunting? It looks like somebody's already been in my class and trying to butter me up. Brought me all these apples. That ain't gonna help you. It's such a nice day outside. Why don't we go outside with this class? What do you think of that? Isn't it the dream of every student to go to a school where all they talk about is bow hunting? I'm in love. Can you see my blackboard here, guy?
Yeah, shows up pretty good.
I got everything I need to teach this class in the back of my big boss here today. The first thing that I want to do is establish some rules. We got rules in every class. No gossip. No backbiting. No slander. And this is one class where I don't care if you help each other. You know, in school, you help the next guy, you get thrown out of school for that. But I want you to help the next guy in this class. That's why I'm here, to help you. Now, the first thing that I want to talk about today is the three kinds of bows. This is not going to be a boring class either. There are three kinds of bows. There's a long bow. Traditionally, a long bow is used in conjunction with a hand-chipped head, a cedar arrow, natural turkey feathers, all wrapped. The rest on a longbow is basically just a shelf with some felt or deer skin or whatever on there. And how you hold your arrow on there, you just cant your bow. When you put the arrow in on a longbow, you tilt the bow over to hold the arrow in there. And the shot goes like this right here. You can see that you can be very effective with a longbow. Now there's disadvantages to a longbow. If you have to get down for a squatting shot, you got to really cant your bow over to make that shot because the bow has a lot of length. Now let's go to an actual hunt and see how it works on an actual animal. We'll go hunt for a white-tailed deer. I know that's exciting. Well, as you can imagine, a double lung shot on that deer, he didn't go very far. He left a good blood trail. We were able to find that animal quick and clean. Now let's check out a recurve. Okay, we've talked about longbows. Now we're going to talk about recurves. For many, many years, a recurve was the top of the line bow to use on the market. And there's a lot of guys that still use a recurve. I still hunt with a recurve occasionally. But a recurve is a very effective bow. It was designed to use with a cedar arrow, homemade chipped heads, turkey feathers, basically the same as a longbow. But modern day bow hunters hunt with aluminum arrows and carbon arrows with a recurve. And if you want to see how effective a recurve is, let's go to a hunt and I'll show you how effective a recurve is on a hunt.
Oh man.
That's a fat.
Oh man.
That's a good buck, man.
That's a dog there.
Well, I guess I don't have to convince you that a recurve will put a deer down. That was a nice buck, and he only went about probably 50 yards. I'd say 50 yards. He was down. And incidentally, some people think that that angle of a shot is an unethical angle and an unethical shot to take. I disagree with that. If it'll put an animal down quick and clean, and if you can get that arrow into the vitals, it's an ethical shot.
Now, talk about the compound bow. You know, a lot of technology has gone into the compound bow, and it's added a new dimension to bow hunting.
The next thing I'd like to discuss in the class is what to know when choosing a bow. There are several things that I'd like to discuss about that. What do we need to know about a bow when we walk into a pro shop? Most pro shop owners can tell you a lot of things. But you have to make the determination, what are you going to do with the bow? Are you strictly going to shoot target? Are you going to hunt with a bow? Are you going to hunt strictly from a tree stand? Are you going to do some stalking? Are you going to go on big game hunts where you got to walk and stalk all day long? These are the things you need to think about when you're choosing a bow. For myself, I like a lightweight quiver, 3 or 4 arrows in it. I like to be able to get the arrows out quick, especially if you're hunting bear on the ground. You need to be able to get that second arrow out of there very quick if you're hunting bears on the ground. You know what I mean? Another reason you need to get the arrows out quick is if you spine a deer, you need to dispatch that animal through the kill zone with a quick second arrow. But what I like to do is keep everything simple on my bow. I like a lightweight bow, a fairly short bow, and I like a bow that I can easily carry in case I have to walk 25 miles through the mountains and walk and stalk all day long. But you need a bow that's tough, durable, one that you can throw around, one that, you know, like we do a lot of hunting on horses. You need to be able to get your bow out of a quiver. We carry scabbards on our horses. We stick it down in the scabbard. You need to be able to have a bow that's tough that'll take that. We do a lot, we haul our bows around in the back of a pickup, four-wheeler, carry them on a motorcycle, in a boat. We just take a bow and we just throw it like that. We really are rough on these bows. So you need a bow, if you're going to hunt, you need a bow that can take a beating. In case you think that throwing a bow around like that destroys the bow, the way I set a bow up for myself, and that's the reason I set it up like that, so it can take that kind of punishment. As you can see, as rough as I am on a bow, I really feel test the bow. You can see how the bow shoots after I'm finished. It can take the rough treatment. That I believe that whatever you need to put on your bow to make you more successful, have more confidence, and be more able to make a quick, clean kill, I encourage you to put it on there. If you need stabilizers, 20 sight pins, kisser buttons, peep sights, releases, whatever you need, I encourage that. I encourage you to use what it takes to make you more proficient as a bow hunter, because we need to make quick, clean kills.
Beautiful guy.
And then the next thing that I'd like to talk about in the class is setting up a bow. Now, what I'd suggest you do if you've never set a bow up before is go to a good pro shop. Doesn't matter where you buy the bow. If you buy a mail order, that's fine. But you need to go to a good pro shop and have somebody help you set the bow up. Now, the way I set a bow up, it's very, very simple. It's basically a traditional way. But to be the most effective, you need to do whatever it takes to make you competent and boost your abilities. And you need to know your limitations when you go out on a hunt. I'm going to take a brand new bow out of a box. This is, believe it or not, my wife is finally going to start shooting a bow after 20 years. Got a cable guard on here. Just snug the cable guard up a little bit. All I use to set a bow up is basically Leatherman pliers. Right out of the box, no rest at all on the bow, no knocking point on the string. Just lay the arrow on there, kind of eyeball it straight. What we're trying to demonstrate here is it can be as simple as you want it, or it can be as complicated as you want it. Now, we will set this bow up with a rest, a knocking point, and everything else, because to be effective every day, day after day, shot after shot, you got to set your bow up. But I just want to show you that you can shoot a bow like this and be effective. Now, that's right out of the box with nothing on it in the kill zone of the animal. Now, let's set it up and I'll show you how you can be effective all day long. The way I set my bow up is very simple, and that's the way I want to show you how I do it today. The reason I'm doing this setup like this is because we get so many thousands of letters and so many guys ask me at shows and wherever I travel around, how do you set your bow up like that? Well, here's how I set my bow up. I need a bow square, a pair of pliers, a center shot, alignment, and a rest. And that's it. All right, what I like to do is put the knocking point right in the pliers, put the bow square on the string, put the center of the bow square right in the center of the AMO hole. Then I like to come up 3/16 of an inch, because we're using the small knock on a beam and arrow. If you're using the larger knock, you have to adjust for that, where you want the center of the square and the center of the hole, because you want the center of the arrow to be the same place on the string. So you got to allow for the half of the width of the knock, which is 3/16. So you just measure up 3/16 of an inch, put your knock on, squeeze it. That's how you put the knock on there. So that's half of the width of the knock. So that when you put the knock up on the bottom of that knocking point, it's centered on your rest. Now what I'm going to do is take a rest out of the package, which this is a Easy Slide Hunter made by Savage. We have these in our catalogs. This is the rest that I recommend myself. We have all these products in our catalog. I'll show you some more things that I really like myself. You got a, in this rest, you got a burger button. We got a Teflon launcher right here. And I'm just going to bring this burger button out so that the arrow sits beside the burger button and the Teflon launcher and align it. It's going to be very, very quick and simple to do this. You just simply put your rest on the outside of the riser. Put your burger button in. You can see it better from here. Get a close proximity here. Then you take the nut on the burger button and spin it down and just kind of snug it up like that. Now, we'll put an arrow on there and we'll check it. This clamp-on bow vise really saves the day. You just clamp it down. Take our bow. This raises up and down. Just put your bow in there. Lots it right down. Very simple. Okay, we got it on the bow press. We got the rest temporarily in place. Now we're going to put an arrow on there and set it on the rest. You set it on a Teflon launcher and a Teflon burger button. Eyeball the thing, get it close. Now, you take this center shot adjustment here. Find a flat spot on the side of the bow that we know is flat. Right here. And what we got to do is, you got a bead on here. You put that bead on the center of the nock on the back side of the bow. That's center. Then you just spin it around and take that same bead and set it in the center of the arrow. That's already very, very, very close. So now what we do is just snug up the nut on the burger button. This is good for me to get started, and then I just make my adjustments as I shoot my bow. As soon as I tighten everything up, we'll see how it shoots right out of the, you know, right off the press. Let's see how it shoots. We got about an extra 6 or 8 inches of arrow here. Yep, a little to the right the first shot. We'll just make our adjustments here. Okay, looks pretty close now. There you go, in the kill zone. One more fine-tuned shot and it'll be right. Put it back on the bow press. This is our bow wrap, insulated casting material. Just put that around the riser. Anywhere that you think the arrow might touch to cut down on the sound. If that arrow was to touch, just wrap that around there. Now, I like to wrap the handle too, because this is an insulator. It keeps your hands warm, keeps your hands cool, depending on the weather. Just keep coming right on around, wrap the handle, and just wrap anything that you think is going to touch. So you got it quietened down. Well, you can see that I've got everything wrapped where the bow, where the arrow won't touch there. I'll put some down in here. Everything's wrapped right now. I want to cover this shelf right here. And then all that's left to do is to put the quiver on. And that's a matter of choice. I like a lightweight quiver that I can get my arrows out quick. I just showed you that on my own bow that I hunt with. I like to have at least 3 arrows in for hunting, and one in there with a judo point. Who knows, when you're sitting in a tree stand, if you get there real early and a predator or small game comes by, you know, you want to take it. You don't want to use your hunting tips. You can use a judo point. But I like to have at least 3 hunting arrows in there, and then one other arrow with the judo point on it. But that's basically how I set a bow up. Tie a couple of cat whiskers on for silencers. You really don't need it on this mountaineer bow, but if your bow has a lot of noise, just tie a couple of cat whiskers on there for silencers and you're ready to go hunting. Put your quiver on. Now, I recommend that you always practice with the quiver on if you're going to hunt with the quiver on. And if you're going to stalk, it's hard to carry your arrows unless you got a quiver. So we'll get into more of that in the next segment of this class. The next thing I'd like to talk about is choosing arrows and tips. These things I know are very controversial. We're not trying to be controversial, and by all means, I don't want to offend anyone deliberately. I'm just giving you my opinion of what works for me, and if it works for you, use it. If it doesn't, go to the pro shop and let them suggest something. I'm just trying to show you how to set a bow up and do what we do. What I'd like to do is point out the basic types of heads that are available. There are the hand chip, flint or stone or bone or whatever, which was is kind of a primitive head. It works well with a cedar shaft and natural turkey feathers. My number one preference of broadheads is a muzzy, and there are several reasons why I choose the muzzy. Number one is accuracy. I love the accuracy I get out of these heads. Straight out of the package, I put them on my arrow, and I get very good flight out of these things. And for many years, I shot the 90 grain four blade, which, if you want to see how effective these 90 grains are, let me just show you two or three shots right here on some animals and show you how effective this small little 90 grain is.
He's history, baby. He's history. Look at that string going up. Is that how to do it? Look at that string.
Well, I think you can see by that the 90 grain is very effective. I've taken most every animal that I've ever pursued with a 90 grain four blade, elk, everything, deer, turkey, bear. They're very effective head. These things are so durable that we've actually done demonstrations shooting through concrete blocks, trees. Let me just show you a past demonstration that we did shooting through a 55-gallon steel barrel. And this is not a rusted away barrel. This is a fairly good barrel. Let's show you how this thing does through a barrel. All right, what I have here is a two-blade, double edge head. A lot of guys love these, a lot of guys swear by these, but this is how it works on an actual cut. It does cut on contact, and it's all the way through now. And as you can see, what it does, it gives you about an inch wide single cut. Now, if you shoot through the lung of a deer or through the skin of the deer, when that goes through, what that does is it closes right back up like that. The pressure of that lung or heart or whatever pulls that right back. Fat, thick skin, it closes it right back up. Now I'll show you why I shoot a multi-blade broadhead. Now I'm going to demonstrate what size hole this little 90 grain puts in a deer. And I'll tell you why I'm doing this. This trocar tip allows the skin of the animal, when the arrow goes into the animal or comes out of the animal, the entry or the exit, it lays the skin down along these blades. And it takes a little more force to put that through, so what that's doing is giving you more cutting edge down the edge of the blades, which is at least an inch and a half of cutting edge down there. But look at the size of the hole when this does come through. Let's look at that hole now in comparison to what you get with just a two-edge hole. That's the hole you get right there. I mean, that's a good size hole. That's a little 90 grain muzzy. So when you see these on the shelf, don't be afraid to get these, because they will put a big hole in an animal. Now think about this. If you're shooting an animal quartering away and that arrow enters that animal on an angle, it'll put a cut in the animal that long. So you get plenty of bleeding with that little 90 grain muzzy. I mean, that's an awesome hole. That's why I shoot it. That's pretty amazing. Just keep in mind that it makes a hole that large in the animal when it goes in, because it pushes, unless it hits a rib, it pushes between the ribs, and then as it exits, it pushes out the skin and does the same thing going out the other side. Another thing I like about it, is if you make a shoulder shot on an animal, which we got a piece of footage where I anticipated the animal to lunge forward, and he didn't lunge forward, so I was aiming partially in the shoulder, and by him not lunging forward, which we all, you know, try to read body language on deer the best we can, but when he didn't lunge forward, I took him right in the shoulder, and check this out, what happened with this muzzy broadhead, what it did to this deer.
Ooh, oh, what a shot! Muzzy, baby, muzzy!
That's one of the best kills that we've ever had on videotape, and probably one of the best demonstrations of what a bow and arrow will do to a deer that I have ever seen. I hope you like that. This right here is a judo point. What it has is some wires on the side of it if you haven't seen one before. When you're shooting a small game, whether you hit them or miss them, these wires grab in the grass and they stand the arrow up. But these things work very well on small game. Check this shot out.
Yes!
Yeah, nice shot, guy!
Pretty awesome. Does the job on small game. All right, what we have here is a fish point, and this happens to be a muzzy. Has a trocar tip on it, just like their hunting heads. When you shoot this into a fish, the barbs keep this from coming back out of the fish. Muzzy has a quick release knock, but I'm going to show you how this works on the end right here. You just simply screw your trocar tip out a little ways, reverse the barbs, and pull the arrow back out of the fish. If you haven't tried bow fishing, this might get you interested in bow fishing. Check this out.
Oh man.
This one right here?
Yep. Boom, baby. Good dog. You sound evil, Dan.
I am a carp slayer.
Both of you guys, both of you. Hang on, guy. Okay.
Way to go, guy.
Okay.
Ready?
Take him, man. Take him. That's a good one. Boom, baby.
Way to go, guy. Boom, boom, boom.
Way to go, guy.
He's a fighter.
Look at that, baby. Baby.
Oh, man. Get him.
Perfect. All right.
No, get him, Dan. Get him. Shoot him. Yeah!
All right.
Got him, baby.
All right.
Hey,
I'm tangled up big
skin,
time.
Bro.
I don't think I have to be too much more convincing on you going bow fishing. But when you go bow fishing, make sure you use a good tip because you're going to be hitting rocks on the bottom and shooting into sand and muck. And you got to have something that's good that you can pull back out. And this cable slide goes through the shank of the arrow, a shank of the head, and right through the fiberglass arrow, so that'll never pull off pulling out of mud or logs or whatever. The next point that I'd like to touch on is styles of shooting. There are many different styles of shooting, and we'll just touch on those. There are a lot of different styles of shooting, and what I mean by styles is some guys like to shoot with their hand open. Some people like to just hold that bow with one finger. Some guys like to have a bow sling on their bow to hold it in place after you release it. Some guys like to cant their bow. I cant my compound bow just like I do a recurve or a long bow. But you know, how you hold your hand is a style. Some guys like to get into the bow like this. Some guys like to draw their bow like this, which I don't recommend. If you draw your bow like this and a deer is standing there looking at you, you got a good chance of that deer seeing you draw that bow. Myself, I like to put the bow up there, put the arrow, have the arrow in there, look straight at the animal, and draw my bow straight back like that. That's a lot less movement. But you have to decide what your style is, practice that style, don't deviate from that style, And then always use that when the moment of truth arises. When that animal walks out, don't be trying to think about what you read in a book or saw in a video. You need to have it up here so you don't have to think about that anymore. Whatever your style is, if when you draw your bow, you have to have your head back, then that's the way you're going to have to do it when you're hunting. If your head is forward, leaning in, whatever your style is, that's the way it's going to be when you go on a hunt. So practice it that way. The next thing I want to talk about is the ways to aim a bow. There's sights and instinctive. Now, what is instinctive? That's controversial. We'll show you what we are thinking when we're talking about instinctive. But sights, I recommend sights for all new hunters, all beginners, and anybody that has good eyes, I recommend using a sight, because you can be a lot more effective and you got pinpoint accuracy with a sight. What I need is a volunteer to come up here and bring your bow and show us what a sight will do on a target. Okay, Marge, you brave soul. Come on up here. Okay, this is a brave soul that came up here. This is Marge Dandy, my secretary. She's got a high-tech bow here. She shoots in competition, IBO, ASA, whatever, the 3D competition. And you can see that she is not opposed to putting high-tech equipment on a bow. And why do you do that, Marge? Why do you have all this on your bow?
Because I'm not a good instinctive shooter.
All right.
I need help.
So by having that on there, though, it gives you all the confidence you need to be able to go out and make a quick, clean kill. Just go ahead and shoot an arrow down in the kill zone of the target there. Just do a demonstration on what kind of accuracy you can get with the equipment. Now she has a release. She has everything on there. Eat your hearts out, you guys. You think she's going to kill something in the video this fall? How many pounds do you shoot, Marge?
52
pounds. So really, you're not learning a whole lot in this class.
Brushing up on things.
Brushing up. All right. Well, you can see that sights give you a lot of confidence. So when you put your sight on what you're shooting at, you are totally depending on the setup of this bow and all the mechanics of the bow, right? Totally dependent on the way you set it up. That's what sights will do for you. And that's why the reason I like sights on a bow is, within 15 or 20 minutes, you can take a fairly new hunter, you working in a pro shop, can take a fairly new hunter in 15, 20 minutes and a half a dozen shots, you have a guy shooting a pretty good group, right? That's why I like sights. Now I'll talk to you about the instinctive shooting. Now you saw how Marge did shooting with sights and a release and all that. Now shooting instinctive, there's several ways to shoot instinctive. You can aim looking down the arrow. Three fingers under, when you draw the thing, put that arrow right under, right on your cheek, look right down that arrow, or you can anchor from your mouth and just figure that you've got 2.5 to 3 inches above the arrow. From the corner of your mouth to your eye is whatever it is, 2.5 to 3 inches, and you've got to allow for that distance. But with me, my right eye is blind, I shoot right-handed, so I look with my left eye where I want to hit. I look there first, then I draw the bow, and I don't look at this equipment anymore. I look where I want to shoot, and I release. I shoot one finger over, two fingers under, and I anchor wherever I need to anchor. I can shoot up like this, I can shoot down like this, and that is a truly instinctive way to shoot. And let me just take you on a couple of hunts, a couple of hunting scenes, and show you how effective that is for me. Perfect lung shot!
Ooh, right, dude.
Well, I think that's demonstration enough to show you that you can be effective that way. You know, I want to be an encouragement to you guys out there. There are a lot of guys write to us and talk to me at shows that are blind in the right eye, left eye, or, you know, they got some handicaps of some kind, whatever. What I'd like to do is be an encouragement to you, and you should be an encouragement to someone else. If you know someone that's got a disability or a handicap, go to that person and work with them and help them. Let me show you what working with a handicap can do. Here's a good friend of mine, Rick Klein. Check him out on this hunt, how he shoots.
Get yourself set. There you go.
Try shooting 70 pounds with your teeth.
Boy, tell us
what you saw when you were shooting over that limb there.
That's all I had. I had a good shot at his lung area right here, but just below the lung was this log right here. And all I was concerned with was just snaking that arrow over the tip of this log, and I didn't miss that log by much.
I knew you
could
do it.
All I could see it just come in there.
Did you know he could do it, Burley?
You betcha. I watched him shoot earlier.
Come on over here, Ken. Here's the man.
Well, what do you think?
Ken, thanks a lot.
Ken Moody.
That was a good deal.
JR.
Good
man,
shot.
This was a good hunt, I'll tell you.
Boy.
Is this what it's all about?
This is.
Now, I've heard a lot of your presentations and shows, Rick, and you're out there promoting hunting, not just bow hunting. You promote hunting. That's what we ought to do. That's what we should be hunting, right?
That's
or should
right.
be promoting.
This is definitely a fair chase hunt. There's just no two ways about it. The animal's got the advantage all the way.
I know you gotta like that. I mean, that's like 70 pounds holding with his teeth on a rainy day after a long jaunt after that hog. That's exciting to me. I don't ever need to shoot another animal in my life. I get a fulfillment and an excitement out of watching my friends accomplish what they set out to accomplish. Hey, hats off to you, Rick. That was great. Now, you saw how that release worked. Marge was using a release. And when she touches that release, it's a very clean release. The string doesn't go back and forth at all. When you shoot fingers like I do, you have what's called plucking the string. When I release that string, if I pull that string to the side, that pulls the arrow to the side. So if you're going to shoot fingers and you haven't been doing that yet, when you get that release, what you want to do is come straight off of that string with those fingers. Don't pull that thing to the side. I shoot a heavy bow for that reason. I just let that torque take that string away from me, come straight back like that, and it's just a follow through, come straight through. Let's check it out.
Right now?
Good.
You want it?
Yeah.
Well, as you can see, that's a very effective way to release an arrow. Let's go to the next step in this class. Well, I tell you, I know that you're all getting antsy to get out there and do some shooting, so why don't we dismiss the class for today? You can go do some bow fishing tonight. Don't stay out too late. I'll see you back here tomorrow. We'll get back into the class. I think I'll go bow fishing too.
Carp, blow it. Carp,
get
him.
Yeah!
Hey! Beautiful!
Hey,
baby!
first shot,
first fish.
All right.
Here's the carp killers. Oh man!
Hey, baby!
You are the baby.
Bring that dude in here.
Man, that's the first shot of the day right there.
Hey, baby.
Way to start the show.
What?
Oh
yeah,
yeah,
baby!
There's another one, Greg. Right there.
Hey!
It's awesome.
Hey, I want to tell you guys something. If you're watching this and you ain't ever shot no cigars, them are small targets right there.
Got it.
Yeah, baby!
Awesome. Were you on him?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Man. There's some tail walking.
Come on, baby. Get back over here to daddy.
There he is. Oh, yeah. Oh,
I baby.
Got
him by the tail.
Welcome back to the class. Today, we got two more topics that we want to cover, and one is the comparison and practicing on the range and practicing for a hunt. On the range, and practicing for the hunt. These are very similar ways to practice, like the IBO, ASA, and 3D in general. If you're not involved in 3D, I became very aware of how effective practice in 3D is, how similar it is to an actual hunting situation. Let me just show you some footage. I hosted the World IBO Championship in 1993, and I was very intrigued at how similar it is to a hunting situation. As you can see, the 3D competition, or just going out on a 3D range, you don't have to be in competition, just going out on a 3D range, it's very similar to an actual hunting situation. The 3D goes on during the rain, when it's windy, whatever. But what I'd like to do now is take the class back outside again and set up for some difficult situations that you might encounter as a hunter. Things are not always perfect when you go out on a hunt. We'll go outside with the class and we'll talk about how I prepare you for those kinds of situations. Can you imagine a deer walking through this brush and you standing where the camera is, you trying to get a shot on this animal? That's very difficult. That's much different than standing on a range. So when that animal is walking through here, are we just going to let the animal go? Are we going to pick a spot and wait for that animal to walk up there and take that shot? Let me bring that home through a little illustration. I'll show you actual practicing in the field. And then we'll actually go to a hunt and use a similar situation to really bring that message home to you.
I tell you, when you have a deer walk down a run like that and you got to shoot through this brush, 9 times out of 10, that deer is not going to see you in this brush if you're still. But you got to come to full draw when you get glimpses of that deer coming through. And when he steps out like that, you got to be able to take that difficult shot. Just like that. I'll tell you what, if you can do that consistently, you're ready for this kind of ambush. If you can't, then you need to wait on this kind of difficult shot. Let's go see how this works on a live deer.
All right, now imagine using this deer for a decoy, and a deer comes into this, and you're positioned out there. The deer comes in, you expect the deer to come in from the side, you expect the deer to come in from one of the angles in the front, or come in face head on, or maybe even come in and try and mount this decoy. But have you ever thought about what it would be if the deer approached and got behind the decoy? What kind of shot would you have if he was behind a decoy? We got a situation where the decoy was sitting up on a riverbank. The deer came in and it was lower behind the decoy. The deer was down behind the decoy. The decoy was sitting on a conduit. So the shot that I had to shoot between the brush, past the conduit, into the deer standing behind. Let me just take you into that situation, that actual scenario, so you can see how you have to be prepared for difficult situations unless you want to go home empty-handed.
Man, hold up, bro.
Man. Look at this. All right, man, okay?
Yeah.
Come on, get over here. Look at that. Dude,
oh, down man.
That tree. Man, what a nice thing.
Now, I'm not promoting or advocating low percentage or iffy shots, but we as hunters have to go up a ladder. You start off on a level and you escalate up as you put more time in and you get more experience. And the reason I say that is you start off driving two hands on the steering wheel, and before long, you're driving with one finger on the steering wheel, holding a coffee cup in the other hand, using binoculars half of the time, scouting going down the road. Is that right? All you hunters know what I'm talking about, right? There he is, there he is. There he is, there he is, there. Get on him, get on him, get on him. Can you get on him? There's a situation that actually happens as a hunter. We're running down a shoreline trying to get up on an animal, say a caribou or an elk or whatever, and you run until you're out of breath. Can you draw your bow when you're out of breath and concentrate and still make that shot? Can you contain yourself while you're or are you going to have a problem drawing your bow and holding? You still got to be able to hold steady or take a snapshot on that animal. Let me bring that home by this illustration. We're running down a shoreline through the black cedar on a caribou hunt, and we get up there. The cameraman's behind me. We got three caribou down there that any one is sufficient to take, and I got three guys telling me, take the one in front, take the one in back. The cameraman tells me the one in the middle I can get on and I can get it perfect, so that's, I focus on the one that I know I'm going to take. And once you make a commitment and focus in, don't let anything right or left detract you from what you're doing. Focus on that kill zone on that animal and put that arrow right where it belongs. Let me take you on that caribou hunt and you'll see how that goes. It's raining, we got on rain clothes, we're running through the alders, we're tripping and falling, we're doing everything. That's a difficult situation, but you have to be able to pull that off, unless all you're ever going to do is stand in a tree stand all day long and wait for that deer to walk out there 20 yards. Most likely he won't walk out there 20 yards anyway. He'll come over there 35 yards, 40 yards. He'll be somewhere where you didn't expect him to be. But let me show you how you can do that under exhaustion of chasing the animal and still be able to pull it off. I think this is probably the best shot that I've ever captured on video. I hope you like this.
What a video!
Who wouldn't like to be in Dan's boots right now? If you really know him at all, you would know that it would be his desire for every true bow hunter to be this blessed. That's what motivates Dan in a video, a 40-yard shot at a truly monster caribou.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed coming to the Dan Fitzgerald Bow Hunting School class session. You know, it's been fun. I've had a good time working with you. I hope you've learned something. But the most important thing is, no matter how much class you go to and how much you read or how much you watch on video or whatever, there's nothing that'll take the place of firsthand experience. And what I mean by that is, you gotta follow that blood trail, you gotta get that blood on your hands before you will ever be effective as a hunter. You know, and you know, some guys have a problem with going to a hunting preserve. If that's what it takes for you new hunters and you beginners, then that's what I suggest that you do. Go to a preserve, get a shot on an animal. That way, if you make a bad shot on an animal, you can still recover that animal. I don't think it's fair in all cases to go out and get in a tree stand and get that adrenaline rush and get all shaken and everything and make a bad hit on an animal and not find that animal. And I've been on a lot of hunting trips where that's happened to hunters. A lot of guys make a shot on an animal and don't recover it. And I say that, you know, put your foolish pride aside. Don't worry about your ego. Don't worry about the peer pressure. If you think it's best for you to go to a preserve to get your first kill or your first six kills or your first dozen kills, till you get that confidence you need to be able to go out there and do it. Remember, it's your hunt. You have to be in control of your hunt. If it's legal, then I recommend that you do it. You take whatever size animal you feel comfortable with. If it's a yearling deer, if it's a doe, if it's a 10-point buck, and I would actually recommend that you start off taking smaller deer, because if you get that once-in-a-lifetime 10-point buck, the first deer, then it's possible that you're going to have a problem later in your hunting. Well, as you can see, there's no more subjects on the board now, so really, this class is about over. And you know, I just want to tell you, I really enjoyed you know, sharing this class with you, and I hope that you've learned something. Even if it's one little thing that'll help you be more successful as a hunter or a fisherman, I think that's going to be worth it all, at least to me. So my suggestion to you as homework until this season, get out there and do some practicing. You know, shoot some woodchucks, some groundhogs. They do a tremendous amount of damage, and that's real good practice. If you can consistently stalk a groundhog or a woodchuck, then probably you'll be able to make that stalk on that white-tailed deer this fall. But until the next class or the next session, God bless you. I appreciate having you in my class. Nah, I don't think this apple is going to talk me out of my backstraps. Buttering up to me is one thing, but you know, an apple won't do. You have to go out and get your own backstraps. Here, have your apple back.